Love is a burning thing and it makes a fiery ring. You're looking at live pictures of a ring of fire, a real one, not the June Carter Cash version right there. This is a solar eclipse. People in the northeastern United States could see a partial eclipse earlier this morning, but you really want to be in Siberia, words you don't hear too often, as well as Greenland and northern Canada to get the most dramatic show. This kind of eclipse happens when the moon crosses between the sun and the earth, as I was just explaining to my next guest, astrophysicist Neil deGrasse Tyson. He's the author of the new book, Cosmic Queries, Star Talk's Guide to Who We Are, How We Got Here, and Where We're Going. So this eclipse that we've been watching all morning long, explain exactly what we're seeing, why it's happening, and the larger cosmic significance.
Well, I wore my eclipse tie just for you this morning. There we go. As the moon going in front of the sun. I was on the Brooklyn Bridge this morning. I'm a resident of New York City. And there were hundreds of people there at 5 o'clock in the morning. Children, old people, people on scooters. And just to bear witness to this occasion where the moon in its orbit around the Earth comes between us and the sun. And as that happens, it takes bites out of the sun, and you have a crescent sun, which is very unfamiliar. Typically, we only think of a crescent moon. So a crescent sun can be quite striking, especially as it rises over the horizon. So I caught bits of it, but then we got clouded out, and so it was sad. But I held an impromptu astronomy lesson on the bridge for anyone who wanted to listen.
That's cool. And look, it's because I'm a jerky cynic that I was joking about the larger cosmic significance, but the larger cosmic significance is we look up and we gaze at the sky. And that is significant because that is, you know, the essence of what it means to be human, to ask questions about why we're here.
You want me to geek out on you? I will. So watch.
That's why you're here.
So here we have the moon in its orbit around the Earth, blocking sunlight while the sun and the moon rise from Earth's rotation. And you have weather conditions such as clouds, which make for an interesting photo. All of this is kind of a cosmic ballet choreographed by the forces of gravity. And if you don't look up, you'll miss it all.
I feel like I need to take a cold shower now, Professor.
I just want to add to that we, as human, we're all born curious, some of us stay curious our entire lives, and the deep questions we ask about how did it all begin? What's it made of? Are we alone in the universe? How will it all end? And so I think an eclipse is just one of the things that celebrate human curiosity and what it took to figure out what's going on when you look up.
So one of the questions that's being asked right now related to this is who else might be out there? There's been so much focus on UFOs because of the reports on 60 Minutes First from the Navy pilots, things that we're seeing, objects that can't be identified. You have a unique perspective on this as someone who has been looking for signs of alien life for a long time.
Yeah, so there's a whole chapter in the book, Are We Alone? And we address what kinds of ways you would ask and answer those questions. And I wish we had better evidence than monochromatic, fuzzy Navy video. You know, if we're being visited by aliens, you know, we upload 6 billion high resolution color photos and videos to the internet every day. We have unwittingly crowdsourcing the observation of the planet. And I want better evidence than that. And just because you don't know what it is, doesn't mean you then know what it is. I'm content to say that's mysterious. I don't know, maybe it's a glitch in the hardware. And if you're gonna say, no, it's not a glitch in the hardware, are you really sure? Are you so sure that you're ready to believe that intelligent aliens are coming to visit us and showing up on F-17 fighter pilot video? Is that more likely to you than maybe you missed something in your hardware? So keep looking for the aliens. By the way, and I'm glad the Pentagon had a program to look for lights in the sky that could harm us. Yeah, okay, $700 billion, put a fraction of that to protect us in case any of that is an enemy craft, or even if it's alien. But I'm just saying, my big fear is that the aliens already landed, but they landed during Comic-Con, and then no one noticed them because everybody was dressed.
It would have been easy to miss.
They're just like us.
Speaking of Comic-Con, I want to ask you about comments and questions asked by Congressman Louie Gohmert during a hearing yesterday. I want to play it for you. He was asking about, well, just listen.
I was informed by the immediate past director of NASA that they have found that the moon's orbit is changing slightly, and so is the Earth's orbit around the sun. We know there's been significant solar flare activity. And so is there anything that the National Forest Service or BLM can do to change the course of the moon's orbit or the Earth's orbit around the sun? Obviously, that would have profound effects on our climate.
So he was asking that question to a forest official, and I don't have the magical superpower to get in Louie Gohmert's head. So I don't know if he was trying to make some point that we can't move the moon, so we can't affect climate change somehow. But what's your takeaway?
No, I mean, okay, so first, let us be clear. When he says BLM, he's referring to the Bureau of Land Management, all right, not the Black Lives Matter movement, I presume. That's first. Second, I don't see, yeah, it sounds a little crazy, but what he's speaking of is something that we call geoengineering. It's doing large-scale things that have large-scale consequences. We already kind of do that. We change the direction of rivers. We dam rivers for our service. We build islands where there was just water before. That's all geoengineering. And we're also geoengineering by warming the planet. So if he wants to think of a geoengineering solution that could help it, I don't have a problem with that, even if it's a little out there. And people had thought about maybe putting sparkly, reflective particles above the clouds that reflect away more sunlight. That would be easier than changing Earth's orbit. So I don't have a problem people thinking about that. I would rather, though, you address the source of the problem rather than after the fact attempt to solve it. Because by then it could be too late and your solution might not work.